Bruchim Habaim B'Shem Adonai. Blessed are you who come here in the name of God. And Bruchim Habaim B'Shem Ha'ahava. Blessed are you who come here in the name of love. And blessed are all of you who come here to celebrate here at Makom Solel Lakeside, our interfaith Thanksgiving service. And we gather in a time of great division in our country. We all know that. But the first Thanksgiving came during Civil War. In times of division, we need gratitude. We need Thanksgiving more than ever. May God lift up the spirit of unity in this sanctuary and in our world. May we join our hands and hearts together in joy and forgiveness and healing. And may we help bring about in our world a refuah shlema, a healing in body, mind, spirit, and soul. Amen.
As we begin this afternoon, let us acknowledge and honor the land we occupy by honoring and acknowledging those native people who were the original stewards of the land where we now reside. We remember that all that is comes from God. We recognize that our communities are located on and near the tribal traditional homes and meeting places of many tribal nations who collaborated as the Three Fires Council, Ojibwa, Ottawa, and Potawatomi nations. Each tribe functioned as brethren to serve the alliance. Midwestern indigenous peoples include the Menominee, Ho-Chunk, Miami, Illinois, Kickapoo, Peoria, Meskwaki, Sauk, and Fox settled in, traveled through, and welcomed others to the Chicago area. As a community of immigrants, it is fitting for us to acknowledge and honor the first people to live here and care for this land. American Indian groups still exist today, despite the historic and cultural campaigns for their removal. They maintain cultural traditions and call Lake County their home. We offer the people of the Three Fires our gratitude and respect, our repentance and hope for solidarity. It is a holy communion we share of life on earth, of past and present, of pain and reconciliation, of majesty and mystery. Let us begin.
Good afternoon. I'm Kevin Garvey. I'm a deacon from Holy Cross Catholic Church, and on their behalf, it is our great honor to join with you, our neighbors, in praying for peace and praying for Thanksgiving. I've read that the Franciscan friars don't actually claim that their founder, St. Francis, actually wrote this prayer for peace, but it does bear St. Francis' name. So let us pray. Lord, make us instruments of your peace. Where there is hatred, let us sow love. Where there is injury, let us bring pardon. Where there is discord, let us bring union. Where there is error, let us bring truth. Where there is doubt, let us bring faith. Where there is despair, let us bring hope. Where there's darkness, let us bring your light. Where there's sadness, let us bring joy. O divine creator, grant that we may not so much seek to be consoled as to console, to be understood as to understand, to be loved as to love, for it is in giving that we receive. It is in self-forgetting that we find. It is in pardoning that we are pardoned. And it is in dying that we are born to eternal life. Amen.
You hear now some familiar tunes, but you'll need to pay attention because the words are new. So, in just a moment, let us sing together. Why don't we stand up for a better sound?
We gather together in joyful thanksgiving, acclaiming creation whose bounty we share, both sorrow and gladness we find now in our living. We sing a hymn of praise to the life that we bear. We gather together to join in the journey, confirming, committing our passage to be a true affirmation in joy and tribulation, when bound to human care and hope, then we are free.
You may be seated.
Good afternoon. Thank you, Religious Leaders United, for this Thanksgiving service. I had the honor last year of participating, and I have the honor again of being here. It's truly a remarkable thing that we all get together, I'd like to say as a community, to do something like this. It's nice, and it's a privilege. Thanksgiving, for me, has always been a special time. For me, it's always been a time for, of course, thanks, but of course, also a time for reflection. So one of the nice things about community is it enables us to welcome and help people that sometimes we can't do alone, and we can't do as individuals. And this is part of that. This time of year is when, as a community, we reflect on so much that we have to be fortunate for, and yet we also reflect on those who are not as fortunate. Yesterday, I was at the North Suburban Church in Deerfield, and I don't know if any of you are familiar with what they do every year this time, but what they do is unbelievable. Hundreds of volunteers gather and pack boxes for those in need, serving thousands of people. So 100 boxes may go to this community or to that organization or here or there. And they load up trucks, literally trucks, of laundry baskets or food baskets for those in need. I was struck by it last year. I'm struck by it this year. And I just ask you to think about that. That's pretty wild. It shows the commitment that we have as a community to help, but it also shows that there are a lot of folks out there who are in need. So we have to think that we're grateful for what we have and grateful to have others do for those in need. I also want to express, in addition to what I did yesterday, my gratitude for the outpouring of care and concern for those that we witnessed from the village of Deerfield who helped the folks in Highland Park for what happened on the 4th of July and what they're still experiencing. And not only Deerfield, but the surrounding communities as well. I think we should all be very grateful that we were able to come together as a community and communities. So as I close these remarks, I just ask you to keep in mind a quote from President Kennedy. He said, as we express our gratitude, we must never forget that the highest appreciation is not to utter words, but to live by them. So I wish all of you a wonderful holiday, wonderful Thanksgiving. Go home to your families. Hug your parents, hug your kids, hug your friends. Enjoy and tell them that you love them. Thank you.
Good afternoon. Thank you so much for the chance to join you. It's a very special celebration. I am so grateful that we can be together in this sacred space. The pause that we take on Thanksgiving helps us realize that we're part of something bigger than our individual selves. And for many, this is a time that highlights incredible challenges that we're facing. This is also a time to recognize that we will continue to support each other as we work to rise above it all. Make no mistake, I understand that some will need to dig deep to find ways to be thankful at this unprecedented time. And as Rabbi Mofik said, we simply cannot ignore the trend of mounting divisiveness across our society. And recently, we experienced threatening and violent behavior in our own backyard. Given these trying times, we rightly grapple with how to respond. But in the face of tragedy, we've seen heroes among us experience the generosity of strangers and neighbors and cultivated responses rooted in joy and pride and affirmation of who we are as a community. It is in this spirit that I hope you'll find solace and gratitude. It is here at home where we can create the change we want to see in the world, support and encourage those without strong voices, and take ownership of our future. We can acknowledge that we are fortunate to live in a community that values freedom and justice, and we can move forward with the courage and confidence to take risks, connect ideas, and care about each other. The human desire to express gratitude is felt across all religious traditions and in secular society. How each of us expresses Thanksgiving takes so many different shapes and styles. And as we weave together our traditions, there's a common theme of gratitude. I am so grateful that we are here together, listening, sharing, working to better understand one another, and helping to make our world a better place. From my family to yours, happy Thanksgiving.
Thank you all for the opportunity to be here with you this afternoon. I'm not sure which of my kids came home with this blessing from nursery school, but it is one that my family used at the dinner table for many years. Thank you for the world so sweet. Thank you for the food we eat. Thank you for the birds that sing. Thank you, God, for everything. Gratitude is not a complicated thing. It's understanding that what you have is enough, and that what you have is a gift to you from God. We know people in our lives that seem to have very little, fewer resources, not much money. Perhaps they are challenged with illness or loss. And we should pray that even in their hearts, they will sense gratitude and have a sense of peace and contentment. This Thanksgiving, let's come to the table with the same sincerity and simplicity and humility that a young child does, simply grateful to his creator for everything around him. And let us also recognize that many of us are endowed with so much more than what we do need. And it's our ability to share with others that truly demonstrates our recognition of the great blessings that God has given us. Thank you for the world so sweet. Thank you for the food we eat. Thank you for the birds that sing. Thank you, God, for everything. Happy Thanksgiving.
I have a conviction and a suspicion that gratitude is an antidote for fear. So as we begin into the many voices of our Thanksgiving service this evening, I want to invite you into a practice of gratitude. But first, I want you to think about what gratitude is and is not. I can say, I'm so glad it's such a beautiful day. I'm so glad to be with you. But gratitude moves the subject to say, thank you for this beautiful day. Thank you for being here with me today. I want to invite us into a practice where literally you could take this home and enjoy it at your Thanksgiving table. You don't even have to start glad. This practice of gratitude is simple. So I would say, I am so glad my husband loves me. And then I would add to it, not three more things I am thankful for, but three things I am thankful for my husband for. I am thankful that he knows how to make pasta primavera. I am thankful that when I am utterly stressed and not sure there is enough of me to go around, that he can make me laugh. I am thankful that when I am afraid, it is his hand that reaches for mine. Gratitude, it takes a subject, it goes farther, and helps us recognize the strength of our living. So wherever you are, sorrow or gladness, I invite you into this practice, not just in your head, but in this moment. Will you turn to the person who is closest to you and choose a thing for which you are grateful and dig it deep to three? Let's take 3 minutes to do this. Will you please? So you see, So you see how simple it is, even when the ground is hard, to find the living seed, to touch its warmth, to feel its promise, and to feel a little less afraid. Will you join me a moment of prayer? You, who some of us call truth, and some of us call love, and some of us call Allah, and some of us call Jehovah, and some of us call Christ, and some of us call God. You, thank you. Amen.
How do I follow that act? Thank you, Pastor Susan. Such a beautiful, beautiful. الحمد لله رب العالمين الصلاة والسلام على سيدنا أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. I greet you with a greeting of peace shared by my Muslim brothers and sisters all around the world. It means may the peace and blessings of God be upon you. In the Muslim tradition, we are guided by God's words in our holy book, the Quran, and by sayings of the Hadith, or the example of the Sunnah, of our beloved Prophet Muhammad. May peace and blessings of God be upon him. Today I'm going to share with you two hadith and the opening chapter of the Quran. Abu Darda reported that the Messenger of God, peace be upon him, said, "The scholars are the successors of the prophets. Verily, the prophets do not pass on gold and silver coins, but rather they only impart knowledge." And so there's no scholar here today from the Muslim faith. You're stuck with me, a Deerfield dad. But it's okay, I'll do my best. The opening chapter of the Quran is not only an introduction to the Quran, it's a framework for our lives. It gives thanks to God and recognizes his glory and his being. It helps us recognize who we are in relation to God. We are dependent slaves in need of his guidance. And it closes with a prayer that we are guided on the example of our prophet. May the peace and blessings of Muhammad, peace and blessings of God be upon him. And so I'll recite for you in Arabic the opening chapter, and then I'll read the translation as well. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين الرحمن الرحيم مالك يوم الدين إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين اهدنا الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين آمين. In the name of God, the All-Merciful, the Mercy-Giving, all praises for God alone, Lord of all the worlds. The All-Merciful, the Mercy-Giving, the Master of the Day of Judgment, it is you alone we worship, and you alone we ask for help. Guide us along the straight way, the way of those upon whom you have bestowed grace, not those upon whom there is wrath, or nor those who are astray. The Prophet, peace and blessings be upon him, told his companion Mu'adh, may God be pleased with him, by Allah, I love you, so do not forget to say at the end of every prayer, O Allah, help me to remember you and to give thanks to you, to worship you well. Thank you for joining me in for the prayer today, and thank you for the invitation. Assalamu alaikum.
Hi everyone, my name is Jake. I am the pastor at Galilee UMC in Highland Park. It's such an honor to be here with you. The scripture that I would like to read comes from the 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verses 16 to 18. The version that I'm going to read is a common English Bible. Rejoice always. Pray continually. Give thanks in every situation, because this is God's will for you in Christ Jesus. The scripture that I just read may remind us that we can rejoice, pray, and give thanks in any circumstances by the help of Christ Jesus. It also may remind us that those who can choose to rejoice, pray, and or give thanks can help those whose circumstances prevent from being able to do so. As we are entering into the season of Thanksgiving, I hope each one of you may be such a person in our community through our acts and work of love and compassion. We can help those in need be a person of Thanksgiving. May God bless you. Amen.
My name is Rabbi Jason Fenster, and it doesn't say it in your program. This is my dear friend and colleague.
Reverend Lucas Hergert from the North Shore Unitarian Church.
And we are honored to share with you this piece of biblical poetry, Word of Thanksgiving. Tov lehodot l'Adonai ulezamer l'shimcha elyon.
It is good to praise the Lord and make music in your name, O Most High.
L'agid baboker chastecha v'emunatcha balelot.
Proclaiming your love in the morning and your faithfulness at night.
Ale asor v'ale navel, ale hiayon b'chinor.
To the music of the 10-stringed lyre and the melody of the harp.
Kisimachtani Adonai b'fa'alecha, b'ma'ase yadecha aranen.
For you make me glad by your deeds, Lord. I sing for joy at what your hands have done.
Ma gadlu ma'asecha Adonai, me'od amku machshvotecha.
How great are the works of your hands, Lord. How profound your thoughts.
Zadik katamar yifrach, ke'erez balvanon yiske.
The righteous will flourish like a palm tree, and they will grow like a cedar in Lebanon.
Shetulim bevet Adonai, bechatzrot Eloheinu yafrichu.
Planted in the house of the Lord, they will flourish in the courts of our God.
Od yenuvun beseva, deshenim beratnim yihiyu.
They will still bear fruit in old age, and they will stay fresh and green.
Lehagid ki yashar Adonai, tsuri velo avlata bo.
Proclaiming the Lord is upright. He is my rock. There is no wickedness in him.
We can be truly thankful to have this opportunity to gather together and to praise and give thanks to our Creator for his many blessings that he has given us. And one of those great gifts that he's given us are the holy writings that show us what God is, how to live our lives. And I would like to share the following writing with you. Thankfulness is of various kinds. There is a verbal thanksgiving, which is confined to a mere utterance of gratitude. This is of no importance, because perchance the tongue may give thanks while the heart is unaware of it. Many who offer this kind of thanks to God are of this type. Their spirits and hearts unconscious of thanksgiving. This is mere usage. This is when we meet, receive a gift, and say thank you, speaking the words without significance. One may say thank you 1,000 times, while the heart remains thankless, ungrateful. Therefore, mere verbal thanksgiving has no significance. But real thanksgiving is a cordial giving of thanks from the heart. When man, in response to the favors of God, manifests susceptibilities of conscience, the heart is happy, the spirit is exhilarated. These spiritual susceptibilities are ideal thanksgiving. There is a cordial thanksgiving, too, which expresses itself in the deeds and actions of men. When his heart is filled with gratitude, for example, God has conferred upon man the gift of guidance, and in thankfulness for this great gift, certain deeds must emanate from him. To express his gratitude for the favors of God, man must show forth praiseworthy actions. In response to these bestowals, he must render good deeds, be self-sacrificing, loving the servants of God, forfeiting even life for them, showing kindness to all the creatures. He must be severed from the world, attracted to the kingdom. The face radiant, the tongue eloquent, the ear attentive, striving day and night to attain the good pleasure of God. Whatsoever he wishes to do must be in harmony with the good pleasure of God. He must observe and see what is the will of God and act accordingly. There can be no doubt that such commendable deeds are thankfulness for the favors of God.
My name is Philip Sherman. I am I'm the new rabbi at BJBE, along with my colleague, Rabbi Jason Fenster, and my colleague, Cantor Jennifer Frost.
Hello, everyone.
We are grateful to be here, and as a new member in this community, I am certainly grateful to share this and so many other sacred days with all of you. From the moment that we wake up in the morning, the Jewish tradition commands that we open our eyes and senses with a deep sense of gratitude. Mode ani lefanecha, how thankful are we to be before you, O God. This offers us an intentional space for gratitude, for the ability to start a new day. Gratitude for the ability to change our lives and the lives of others, for the ability to learn and the ability to walk in this world with curiosity. For the ability to be in sacred connections with others and God, and for the ability to, in some small way, prepare our world. In this way, we bring forth the divine light that sits within us, waiting to illuminate our world, to light a path for us of goodness and possibility, of thankfulness and peace. One way to activate this light is to reflect and acknowledge gratitude. The big things and the small things that we encounter and experience every single day. And when we find a sense of awareness for that gratitude, when we notice its amazement and wonder, when we notice it in our lives, we can give thanks to God with a blessing that we call Shehechianu, a blessing that literally gives thanks to God for life, for the ability to walk in this world. And so on this Thanksgiving week, in this important and sacred space, we give thanks to God for giving us life, for sustaining us to be in this world, and for allowing us to reach this moment in time. So let us share this blessing together. If you know the words, I invite you to join with us. If not, an amen at the end will do just fine.
Baruch ata Adonai Eloheinu melech haolam Shehecheyanu vekimanu vehigianu lazman hazeh. Let's try that again. Baruch ata Adonai Eloheinu melech haolam Shehecheyanu vekimanu vehigianu lazman hazeh. Here it comes.
Who gives us life, who sustains us, and allows us to reach moments of gratitude and celebration, and together we can say, Amen.
Amen.
Starting to wonder what I did to have to follow that. That was remarkable. And here comes a Protestant clergyman to butcher a reading of Deuteronomy for you this afternoon. Friends, I invite you to listen to the word of our Lord just one more time as we read it in Deuteronomy chapter 26, verses 1 through 11. When you've come into the land that the Lord your God is giving you as an inheritance to possess, and you possess it and settle in it, you shall take some of the first of all the fruit of the ground which you harvest from the land that the Lord your God is giving you, and you shall put it in a basket and go to the place that your Lord your God will choose as a dwelling for his name. You shall go to the priest who is in office at the time and say to him, Today I declare to the Lord your God that I have come into the land that the Lord swore to our ancestors to give us. When the priest takes the basket from your hand and sets it down before the altar of the Lord your God, you shall make this response before the Lord your God. A wandering Aramean was my ancestor. He went down into Egypt and lived there as an alien, few in number. And there he became a great nation, mighty and populous. When the Egyptians treated us harshly and afflicted us by imposing hard labor upon us, we cried to the Lord, the God of our ancestors. The Lord heard our voice and saw our affliction, our toil, and our oppression. The Lord brought us out of Egypt with a mighty hand and an outstretched arm, with a terrifying display of power and with signs and wonders. And he brought us into this place and gave us this land, a land flowing with milk and honey. So now I bring the first fruit of the ground that you, O Lord, have given me. You shall set it down before the Lord your God and bow down before the Lord your God. Then you, together with the Levites and the aliens who reside among you, shall celebrate with all the bounty that the Lord your God has given to you and to your house. Friends, this is the word of our Lord. Thanks be to God. I do realize that it could be a bold move to turn towards the Hebrew Bible and preach on a text found in Deuteronomy as a Christian pastor in a Jewish house of worship to an interfaith congregation. The chances of me misunderstanding or misrepresenting the scripture in front of such a community is probably pretty good. Christian clergy are notorious for loving Jesus so much that we'll try to make any piece of scripture that we read all about him. And as much as I love that guy, I will try my best not to do that this afternoon. I'm really honored to be here with you, and to have been asked to deliver today's message. And I bring with me the blessings, prayers, and well wishes of the entire Highland Park Presbyterian Church, and I find it truly wonderful that we should be gathered here in this place together to give thanksgiving as a community.
Our two congregations specifically, the Highland Park Presbyterian Church and this temple, have a shared history of worshiping together in the same building. And it's my hope then that this service may be a beginning of a rekindling or a rejuvenation of sorts of that shared worship, that deeper relationship and that mutual support of all our faith communities during these troubling times of deep division in our greater community and society. With the appalling rise of anti-Semitic rhetoric in our country, especially of late, it's all that more important for those of us with a true love of God to make our voices more clearly heard and our actions more visibly seen. As one of the sacred texts from my tradition asks us, how can you say that you love God and yet hate another brother or sister? And so it's good. It's very good that we are gathered in this space at this time as this one community to give thanks and praise to our God, to affirm our universal commonality as God's precious children, to give voice and a face to what a deep love and a deep faith looks like and is. When the rabbi asked me what text I would like to use this afternoon, I selected this passage from Deuteronomy, not just because it talks about giving thanks to God, or I thought that it might be a bold move to do so, but what intrigues me the most about this text is how it takes three integral aspects of ancient Israelite worship and unites them together and ties them together. It takes history, it takes worship, and it takes invitation. As the theologian John Holbert notes, this scripture points us to consider that right memory leads to right worship, which then leads us into inclusive celebration. And what could be more fitting for our purpose here this afternoon? We have to remember where it is we came from. We have to remember what it is that we've been through. We have to remember what it is we've struggled with in order to get here where we are now, in order to truly worship God with thanksgiving, in order to truly have gratitude for all that we are now blessed with. And it tells us that here in Deuteronomy, when we do that, when we remember and come to God in true praise and thanksgiving with open hearts to give back, it says, then you, together with the Levites and the aliens who reside among you, shall celebrate with all the bounty the Lord your God has given to you and to your house. And it all starts with that remembering, with remembering the past correctly. Remembering the hardships and the wandering and the struggle and the faith it took to get us to where we are today. That memory of the past should be firmly planted in our minds. My friends, we would be remiss if we gathered for our worship here this afternoon without a keen awareness of the darkness of our summer and the tragedy that beset another national celebration as we prepare for the festivities of this upcoming national celebration. And so as we gather here today, this afternoon, in praise and thanksgiving for God and for one another, we remember. We remember the lives lost. We remember the lives changed. We remember the blood spilt. We remember the hearts broken in senseless tragedy and in darkness that befell our town on a sunny and beautiful July morning. We remember. We must remember. And
yet the Deuteronomist reminds us that it's not enough to just remember. And it's not enough to just simply recite back our memory in worship. But that memory of what's come before, that memory of what's happened and brought us here, that if it's truly remembered and properly understood, it should call forth something from us. It causes us to offer back to God a portion of who we are, and it calls us to offer up our first fruits, as it were, back into the service of God and God's will out of gratitude. Gratitude for what, you may ask? I suspect that answer is as broad and varied as the number of people gathered here in worship this afternoon. Gratitude that our community came together. Gratitude that we walked through the storm so far united. Gratitude that we're still here. Gratitude that a light still shines through the darkness and the darkness cannot overcome it. Gratitude that even in the face of unspeakable hatred, there's still an unfathomable depth of love. Gratitude that our God never abandons us. Gratitude for life itself. And what happens, according to the author of Deuteronomy, is that this act of remembrance, when combined with this deep gratitude, it evokes in us and calls us to offer something back to God, something in service to God. It's a particular expression of service here. It's an inclusive celebration. It invites the Levite, the landless priest, and the stranger. I believe in Hebrew the word is ger, meaning sojourner, or perhaps maybe better translated into contemporary English as immigrant. In essence, right memory leads to right thanksgiving and gratitude, which then leads us into inclusive community. Because we know where we've come from, because we know the hardship that it's taken for us to be a community and a people who have weathered the storms of life together, because we know the struggles it's taken just for us to get this far, not only should it fill us with a profound sense of gratitude that we're here and have what we have, but it should open us up and make us more empathic to those who continue to struggle and feel displaced in our world today. And I pause here just for a moment to wonder out loud with you if I, as a white heterosexual male member of the Protestant clergy, can truly understand the impact, the implication, and the profundity of that claim made here in Deuteronomy. I stand here keenly aware of my privilege, dare I say, unmerited privilege that I've been afforded in this life. And if I am to take Scripture seriously, then I must realize that privilege comes to me as a gift that should be turned over to God as a social responsibility to be radically inclusive, to work for the marginalized, the disaffected, the persecuted, the alien, and the sojourner, and the lost among us. And yet maybe God's word for us today is somehow found in my ramblings this afternoon, that we, as a community of great privilege, have yet suffered great tragedy. And yet as we begin to find the other side of that we can find such gratitude and such thanksgiving for God and one another that we can use our privilege, our resources, our gifts, our first fruits, as it were, to be radically inclusive, to build a community that reflects even more closely God's vision for us and for our world. That our right memory can lead to right worship, which can lead to inclusive celebration. And so may this Thanksgiving be one where our memory and our gratitude fill our festive boards to overflowing for all that, in recognition of all that God has given us. May we know truly what a gift and a privilege we've been given by being able to be in community with each other. And may that proper remembrance and true thanksgiving break our hearts wide open for all those who are still not considered insiders. May this Thanksgiving remind us that there are those in our midst who feel that they have limited or no access to the bounty of God's love. And we then, we who've been given so much by the grace of God, are the ones called to invite them into the feast, called to help them celebrate in the bounty God has prepared at the table of all of our hearts and in all of our homes. May we together remember who we are and where we've come from. And may we worship together in true thanksgiving to God for all that we have. And may our celebrations be as inclusive as God demands. Amen.
Today we will be receiving an offering to benefit the Deerfield Free Store. It's a store that's for folks who are refugees who are being resettled. We're also giving to Moms Demand Action, a group formulated to stop gun violence. I heard a story when I was a kid, and I've heard it many times since. I have good news and bad news. The good news is we have enough money to supply these two places with enough money to last their entire life. Good news, right? But the bad news is it's in our pockets. Stewardship, sharing with one another, sharing what we have, taking care of what we've been given. Like prayer, giving is a kind of communication of where your heart is and where you are with each other and with God. It's a way to show that you value something, that life means something special to you, for it is in giving that we realize that we've been blessed. Giving is an action, a physical, decisive action that one takes out of the goodness of their heart. And through this action, those who give something very valuable are given something in return. Meditate on the way your giving would bring you closer to the holy today. None of us ever do anything great on our own. Without support, we would be nothing, we would do nothing, we would have nothing around us. That's why I ask you to remember today where your gifts come from, and how important it is to give thanks through giving. So we designate our gifts to the Deerfield Free Store and to the Moms Who Demand Action. We ask you to give freely and generously as we serve and as we give in our community, as we show our gratitude this Thanksgiving.
We're going to have an opportunity now to pray together. And your parts will be in bold italics, but I'm going to be saying it along with you because I've learned that we're being live streamed. So in order for them not to have big gaps of silence that mean nothing, I'll be reading your parts as well. Let us pray together as an interfaith family. We are thankful for the splendor of the whole creation, for the beauty of this world, for the wonder of life, and for the mystery of love. We are grateful for the blessing of family and friends, and for the loving care which surrounds us on every side. We give thanks for tasks which demand our best efforts, and for being led to accomplishments which satisfy and delight us. Earth, teach me quiet, as the grasses are still with new light. Teach me suffering, as old stones suffer with memory. Teach me humility, as blossoms are humble with beginning. Teach me courage, as the tree that stands alone. Teach me limitation, as the ant that crawls on the ground. Teach me freedom, as the eagle that soars in the sky. Teach me acceptance, as the leaves that die each fall. Teach me renewal, as the seed that rises in the spring. Teach me to forget myself, as melted snow forgets its life. Teach me to remember kindness, as dry fields weep with rain. There are so many favors and blessings that we need to be thankful for, blessings that we take for granted. We must show our thanks in our actions every day. Let's be thankful for our blessings by thanking those people who deliver those blessings to us. Let's thank the workers, the farmers, the laborers, the drivers, and all the good people by treating them fairly, the way we would like to be treated. Let us show thankfulness by helping promote a culture of justice and equity to all. We give thanks by remembering our freedom. We are thankful for the freedom from hunger. We are thankful for the freedom to challenge our minds. We are thankful for the freedom to chart our lives. We are thankful for the freedom to work for a better world. We are thankful for the freedom to celebrate this day. We pray for our country, for the men and women who today are protecting our freedom, and for the day when this nation and the entire world will know peace. We give thanks for all the good in our lives. We think of our many brothers and sisters who go without each and every day. May this feast of community compel us to work to better care for all of those in the world who need our love and generosity the most. We remember in this season of bounty all those who do not have enough, who are afraid, who are lonely, and who suffer. We wish for the abundance of this world to be shared, for fear to become love, for the lonely to feel welcomed, and for the suffering to know rest and joy. For the labor, the love, the care that gave the delights of this and every day, we say thanks. For the nourishment of our spirit, the challenges that strengthen us, the friends we have on the journey, we say thanks. For all that is in our lives, for these good gifts, we whisper thanks. Overflowing with gratitude, let us shout thanks. In this season of reflection, we look back over our lives and over the year past, and we acknowledge the ways the seasons have shaped us. We rest in the knowledge that a greater purpose is accomplished both with and despite us, and we understand that every part of our journey is an opportunity for us to grow. May we go forward, walking in kindness, passing peace to all we meet, and loving generously and intentionally, and may gratitude be reaped and sown in our hearts. Amen. Before our final moment together, I want to take a moment of personal privilege to introduce myself as the newest convener of Religious Leaders United, and to call to our attention again our committed purpose, that we are dedicated to sharing the ethics and virtues common in our traditions, including kindness, love of neighbor, hospitality, generosity, justice-seeking, truthfulness, and trustworthiness. And one of the projects, of course, that we do to express that is this gathering here. But I just want to forewarn all the religious leaders among us that I'm going to be making the rounds to visit you and pick your brains. I'm also going to be visiting the mayors to find out how ideas for how we might strengthen our work together toward that which we believe in. And would invite us in this final song to use this not just as a moment of singing together, but as a commitment expressing what we really want to happen in our world. For we know that the forces that want to hate and divide and destroy are still hard at work. There was another mass shooting last night in Colorado Springs. 18 people shot, 5 killed at a gay and lesbian bar in Colorado Springs. So let us continue to remember that our work of our being one people together for the cause of good in the world is so vitally important. I'm gonna sing the chorus of this, which we will then sing together twice. Then I'm going to sing a verse, and we'll sing the chorus again twice. The words are on the back of your program. Let us stand. Draw the circle, draw the circle wide. Draw the circle, draw the circle wide. No one stands alone, we'll stand side by side. Draw the circle, draw the circle wide. Draw the circle, draw the circle wide. Draw the circle, draw the circle wide. No one stands alone, we'll stand side by side. Draw the circle, draw the circle wide. Draw the circle wide, draw it wider still. Let this be our song. No one stands alone, standing side by side. Draw the circle, draw the circle wide. Draw the circle, draw the circle wide. Draw the circle, draw the circle wide. No one stands alone, we'll stand side by side. Draw the circle, draw the circle wide. Draw the circle, draw the circle wide. Draw the circle, draw the circle wide. No one stands alone, we'll stand side by side. Draw the circle, draw the circle.
Will you be seated for a moment? When we invite clergy and dignitaries from our community to be here, it's amazing when everybody comes. And it's always, you know, schedules being what they are, it's very difficult. But Representative Morgan got here a little late, but but not by his fault. There were things that happened because of that shooting in Colorado that caused you to late for us today. But so we're so honored that you're here, as we're honored that all of our dignitaries and all of our friends, all of our community is here.
Thank you, Rabbi, and good afternoon, everyone. My apologies for being late. For those of us who work in policy and trying to enact change, in particular those who are in the race to reduce gun violence, many of my partners here, Mayor Rotering, Mayor Shapiro, Senator Morrison, it's a race that we have with urgency because every day that we wake up that we have not dramatically reduced gun violence, we know it's another day that we can wake up and read in the news another story about a mass shooting as we had this morning. In Colorado Springs, our family and our community, the LGBT community that wakes up in grief, horror, fear, that we stand in solidarity today. The failure to meet the urgency, as we saw just a few weeks ago with a mass shooting in East Garfield Park in Chicago, another community that was literally there to mourn gun violence, experienced more gun violence. So I'm here today to ask you to continue to pray with me that we can act with the urgency that this moment requires to make sure we don't continue to wake up day after day after day to experience that gun violence. So thank you for being here today. Thank you for bringing your hearts and your prayers with us and letting me be a little bit late today. Thank you.
In Psalm 118, it says, it's the Lord's doing, it is marvelous in our eyes. And indeed, this is one of God's marvels. It's a marvel that we can all be together, that we can bring community together to celebrate, to think about Thanksgiving. And this is a tradition that's gone on for quite a long time. This is my 25th year of service in Highland Park. When I got here, it was one of Reverend Worthington's predecessors who told me about this organization, which was at that time called the Southeast Lake County Clergy Association. And then it became Cell Circle, and now it's RLU, Religious Leaders United. But even then, there had been decades of these Thanksgiving services of the community coming together. And so we've been doing this for a very long time. I do want to say that this is the first time that we've had a reading from the Quran. And that is a remarkable moment to treasure, that the diversity in our community continues to grow, expand. So Asif, thank you for coming, sharing the words today. The very next verse in that psalm, Psalm 118, is, this is the day that God has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. So we invite you to keep that verse with you wherever you go, this day, every day, on Thanksgiving, throughout your lives. And remember, each day, even on the difficult ones, even on the painful ones, that this is the day that God has made. It's up to us to find a blessing. It's up to us to find a way to rejoice and be glad. May God be with you as you came in, as you go out, from this time forth and forever. Amen. Thank you for our musicians today as well. I invite you to continue.